nobody's eating, it shouldn't be this quiet in here.
Ooh.
We went to the funeral about a week ago, and there were two tables, and everybody was just like they'd never seen each other before, which I hadn't seen half of them before. And all of a sudden, it got quiet, and I looked, but I told Marie, I said, they must be eating. It got quiet, and they were all eating. So. Join me on 772 when we all get to heaven. Oh, that's not it. My bad. It's on screen, 772. I mean, just forget what I said. Join me on this song here.
Hey, how y'all?
Churchy terms. When I first got saved, some about 5,000 years ago, I think, I remember as a young man, I'd heard all these churchy terms starting to come at me. And one of them that just confused the nonsense out of me was the term by and by. What in the world does that even mean?
It's more Southern than anything.
I think so. I heard a few songs said by and by. And it, by context, you know what they're talking about, but it's like, where did that come from? Anybody know? I didn't think so.
It had to be the South.
Had to be the South. That's what Randy was saying. It's a Southern thing.
I love it.
It's hard to talk clearly when you got all those grits in your mouth. I love me some grits. Ooh, baby. Pardon me? Who said what?
Do you know the road to Colorado will show you?
I love grits. In Colorado, when we talk about grits, we said, what's a grit look like? Oh, no. Oh, no. A little pepper, maybe. A little butter if you have to. But. Ooh. But y'all eat them any way you want.
Y'all hush. You're making me hungry again.
Now, you know, we got to eat. That reminds me of what you were talking about. You think it's a coincidence that God caused us to have to speak with the same orifice that we eat with?
Yeah.
No, that's the only time
we eat. We're not supposed to talk while we're eating.
Southerners never shut up.
That's true. Father God, thank you for your mercy, your grace. Thank you for bringing us here again this evening. Help us to build on our relationship with you. Help us to worship you with our songs, with our spirits, with our minds, with our psychology. Help us simply to sing and surrender everything to you this evening, and then to learn and draw closer. Be with us. Fill this place. Fill our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
Now join me on 772. When we all get to heaven, what a time that's going to be, amen. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, he'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sign. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing there will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing there will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon his beauty we will soon. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing there will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Yeah, you ain't gonna walk in there very demure, because I don't know about you, but I'm gonna be shouting my head off. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Go with me to 750. Peace like a river. He talks about that some more than rivers.
I got peace like a river, I got peace like a river, I got peace like a river in my soul. I got peace like a river, I got peace like a river, I got peace like a river in my soul. I got love like an ocean, I got love like an ocean, I got love like an ocean in my soul. I got love like an ocean, I got love like an ocean, I got love like an ocean in my soul. I got joy like a fountain, I got joy like a fountain, I've got joy like a fountain in my soul. I've got joy like a fountain, I've got joy like a fountain, I've got joy like a fountain in my soul.
Can't always see it on my face, but like the song says, it's in my soul. So, let's sing "Somebody Touched Me."
Glory, 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 somebody touched me. Glory, 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 somebody touched me. Glory, glory, glory. must have been the hand of the Lord. Glory, 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 somebody touch me. Glory, 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 somebody touch me. Glory, 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 somebody touch me. Must have been the hand of the Lord.
While I was shouting,
somebody touch me.
While I was shouting,
somebody touch me.
While I was shouting,
somebody touch me. Must have been the hand of the Lord. Glory, 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 somebody touch me. Glory, 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 somebody touch me. Glory, 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 somebody touch me. Must have been the hand of the Lord.
While I was singing,
somebody touch me.
While I was praying,
somebody touch me.
While I was shouting,
somebody touch me. Must have been the hand of the Lord. Glory, 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 somebody touch me. Glory, 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 somebody touch me. Glory, 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 somebody touch me. Must have been the hand of the Lord. Must have been the hand of the Lord.
And let's sing the Spring of the Living Water, seeing how God's getting ready to give us some. Time.
Thank you.
So you don't need,
that. Thank you, brother. That was a nice set. I enjoyed that. Wait a minute.
Yeah.
I got to turn it on, right?
Helps.
Sometimes I wonder about my sanity. Sometimes you wonder about my sanity. But more than anything, sometimes I worry about your sanity. God is good. We are, don't turn there because we're not going there, but we are in the middle of Revelation chapter 15. Why are we not going there? Well, because of this. I have taught through the book of Revelation half a dozen times over the last 20 years. And every time I've taught through it, I've always thought this is the point right here where we need to jump back into the Old Testament and deal with the concept of the day of the Lord, specifically from one book. I've never done that. Always been in too much of a hurry to finish. But I got a feeling I'm not going to finish this year anyway because the Lord's coming back. What do you think about that?
Very soon.
Come on. Have a little faith. All right. I have no idea when the Lord's returning. So what we're going to do today is as we move into this portion of time when the angels with the bowls of God's wrath are coming out of the temple, sent there from the temple, given that which they will simultaneously bring on the earth, the greatest part of God's wrath. When we see some of the horrific things that will happen and we discuss how deeply devoluted this world will become in a very short period of time, when we see the smoke fill the temple as the angels leaving, which basically is a way of telling us very clearly, don't approach God until this is finished. And we understand this is all leading up to that one point when Christ will have drawn all of the enemies of God together into one place, and he will return in clouds of glory with you and me and so many others, and he will bring destruction and the end of redemption, and he will take his place on the throne of David to reign for 1,000 years. We also talked a little bit about that missing part of Daniel's 70 weeks. The fact that if you do all the arithmetic, you end up with 75 missing days. And I'm going to show you those missing days. And we're all going to do all of this by going back to the book of Joel.
Correct. Look at that.
Correct. Right where you were, huh? Yeah. Joel, I think your bookmark's always in the book of Joel. What do you think?
I thought that's where you're going.
Yeah, we are going to the book of Joel, and this is the most amazing thing you're going to ever hear. We are going to study the entire book of Joel in the next 45 minutes. Do you think we can?
No.
You know why I know we can? Calvin's not here. I'm sorry. If you tell him I said that, I'm going to be...
We couldn't do Jesus with in 45 days.
No, we couldn't, of course. But what we're going to do is look at the book of Joel from a purely eschatological standpoint. And we're going to walk through it very quickly, and we're going to look at a few particular places, and we're going to dive deep in a couple of places. And it's going to be, I think, illuminating to a lot of us. The book of Joel is like a lot of those lesser prophets. I don't like calling them the lesser prophets. But nevertheless, a lot of the smaller prophetic books after the major prophets that... if you're not careful, sometimes it's very difficult to figure out what they're talking about and what historical events they're talking about. The book of Joel has, if you go out and start reading commentaries, you'll find 1,000 different viewpoints on it. That's okay. My viewpoint's the only one that counts.
It doesn't.
The only one that counts to me. And I am really good at standing up and saying, I've studied this a lot and I believe I'm right, but if y'all disagree with me, that's cool too. Because in the end, God's going to straighten. I don't know if God's going to straighten all that out. We may get up to heaven and he may say, yeah, okay. 72%, Mike, that's pretty good. Which is all right with me. But let me show you how this works. The book of Joel, did you find yourself there? I'm going to actually come down there and speak from down there, if you don't mind. Forgive me for this. I've never done this before. I hope I never do it again. But I am half expecting an emergency phone call. So if my phone starts vibrating and I miss it, let me know, okay? Ooh, mysteries upon mysteries. Father God, open the book of Joel to us now. Let us see what you are saying through this great prophet, through his prophecy, his condemnation, his call to repentance, and his wonderful, glorious picture of what will take place as Christ takes his throne. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Understanding the book of Joel, whether it means anything to you or not, probably written right at or around 835 B.C. So the book of Joel was written actually right after Israel and Judah disintegrated, became two nations, but before any of the stress in any of the nations like Assyria, and then finally Babylon come in and take them captive. He's going to speak to a little bit to what's going to happen, and we're not going to spend a lot of time on that, because what Joel does is he starts out with a discussion of an event that Israel, all of Israel, had just lived. Man, y'all just got to slap me around on Sunday nights. Lived through, and that would be an incredible locust infestation. And locusts come in, and when the locusts come in, they come in, and you nothing you can do about it, right? I mean, they come in hordes. They take the green land, and they just come across in this great swath, and they move quickly, and there's nothing that's going to help. And it's interesting when you see a picture in a third world nation, even today, when locusts come through, as they take pictures from the air, you see green, lush, verdant land in front of them. The locusts move through, and as the locusts move through, there's nothing left. It's all dark. It's all dirt. There's no vegetation left at all. It's destruction. And when the locusts come into a city, they do the same thing. They're marching straight ahead. They're going in one direction. They start crawling over the buildings, into the windows, into every crevice and orifice they can find, and they fill everything and destroy everything. And so he starts with that event that had just happened very recently. We don't know exactly when, but it would have been within a couple of years, and it would have been devastating the entire nation. And he builds from that a prophecy that God has given him about what will take place on a short-term basis. So what he's doing is he's taking this event, he's using it as a picture. I never can figure out the difference between similes and metaphors and analogies. I'm not worried about that. It's more of a picture. He builds a picture of how God's judgment is going to come upon Israel in the next 300 to 400 years, very shortly, but does that very quickly, because immediately he's going to take that picture and say, and by the way, what I'm really talking about is what's going to happen in the day of the Lord. And when he talks about the day of the Lord, when Daniel talks about the day of the Lord, when Zechariah and Zephaniah talk about the day of the Lord, they're talking about the entire tribulation period, that 70th week of Daniel, that 7-year period. But when Joel talks about the day of the Lord, he's talking about this last part, this part where we begin to see the angels with their bowls of wrath coming out of the temple of God in heaven, ready to deliver God's wrath upon the earth. Look at that. The day of the Lord is the direct destruction, the final destruction of all that stand against God upon this earth, and then Christ's return and setting on the throne and what will take place directly after that. All right? Enough of that? You got the book of Joel in front of you? We're going to read it. And I'll just make a few comments as we walk through. The word of the Lord that came unto Joel, son of Pethuel. Where'd my book go? Sorry. Hear this, ye old men, and give ear, all you inhabitants of the land. Hath this been in your days, even in the days of your father? That's an interesting statement. I think I've lost my notes. Doesn't matter. Had this been in your days, even in the days of your father? It's a rhetorical Hebrew question that basically says, this didn't happen to you. It didn't happen to your fathers. It's going to happen in the far distant future. And he backs that up by going into this next verse when he says, not you, but tell your children of it, and let your children tell their children, and their children another generation. It's a third level way of saying, keep telling your children, because this is coming, and it may not come soon. It's going to come way down the road, but make sure you pass this prophecy along to the generations to come. Well, we're fastly approaching the final generations that will hear this. Now remember, This is primarily given to Israel, as most prophecies are. So we kind of are on the ancillary set of this, watching these events, hearing about these events. It will affect all nations, big time affect all nations, but the prophecy and the promises are to Israel. And then he looks back, maybe a couple of years, to the locust infestation. He says, that which the palmer worm hath left, hath the locust eaten. That which the locust has left, hath the cankerworm eaten. And that which the cankerworm hath left, hath the caterpillar eaten. So basically, nothing left, guys. And nothing will be left when we focus further ahead. He says, awake, ye drunkards, and weep and howl, all ye drinkers of wine, because of the new wine, for it is cut off from your mouth. I'd like to preach that. I'm not going to do that tonight. And not the way you think. Don't assume. For a nation is come up upon my land, strong and without numbers, whose teeth are the teeth of the lion, and he hath the cheek teeth of a great lion. He hath laid my vine waste, barked my fig tree. He hath made it clean bare and cast it away. The branches thereof are made white. And that's one of the things the locusts will do when they come through. They not only take all of the grain and all of the wheat type of plants, but they also move and grab the trees, and they eat the bark and kill the trees that stand before them as well. So they lay bare the bark. Lament, verse 8, like a virgin girded with sackcloth for the husband of her youth. The meat offering, the drink offering is cut off from the house of the Lord. The priests and the Lord's ministers mourn. The field is wasted, the land mourneth, for the Lord corn is wasted, the new wine is dried up, the oil languisheth. Now, this is kind of an interesting picture. What he's saying is this. All the harvest is gone. The barley harvest is gone. The wheat harvest is gone. Those are the first two harvests of every year in Israel from the very beginning. There is no waving of the sheaf the year that the locust came through in the Thanksgiving offering, in the thank offering, the first fruits offering. There is none of that going on. It is over. There is no food. There is a dearth of food. Obviously, this is a point in time when many of the people in Israel will be migrating to try to find some place where there is food, because there's nothing left here. It is a devastating thing to happen in an agri-economy. Verse 11. Be ye ashamed, O you husbandmen, not because they did anything wrong, but any farmer who looks at his field and is completely destroyed and there's no hope left, is the term here doesn't talk about shame for fault, but shame for absolutely no hope left. Howl, O you vine dressers, for the wheat and for the barley, because the harvest of the field is perished. The vine is dried up, and the fig tree languished, the pomegranate tree, the palm tree, also the apple tree, even all the trees of the field are withered, because joy is withered away from the sons of men. These people, when they first read this, when it was read to them, they knew exactly. They just lived through this. But he's about to step off of this and start pointing to the future. Gird yourself, he says, as in a command for the future, and lament, ye priests. Howl, you ministers of the altar. Come, lie all night in sackcloth, ye ministers of God, for the meat offering and the drink offering is withholden from the house of your God. Sanctify yourself a fast. So he says, gird, lament, sanctify a fast. Call an assembly. Call everybody together. Gather the elders and all the inhabitants of the land into the house of the Lord your God, and turn to the only place, the only person you can turn to in such a tragedy. Cry unto the Lord. Now he moves. Alas. Yes.
Can I make a comment that just hit me? When it says sanctify a fast, everybody's bemoaning being hungry, and they say, oh, let's make it a holy thing.
Yeah.
Well, they just flip the attitude.
Yeah, I like that part. I wasn't going to touch on that, but you're absolutely right. I'm glad you brought that up. They flip the attitude. They say, what you're going through, turn it to God. Cry unto the Lord. That's very perceptive. Sunday nights in words. Alas for the day of the Lord is at hand, and as a destruction from the Almighty shall future perfect it come. So he just makes the turn here, and he says, what you experienced ain't nothing compared to what's coming. And the day of the Lord, that single day, not necessarily a 24-hour day, but that single point in time when the vengeance of the Lord will come, it will come from him, okay? It will come as a destruction from the Almighty, and it shall come. And when you look forward to that, he says this, is not the meat cut off before our eyes, yea, joy and gladness from the house of our God, just by the as the locusts? It's coming this way again. The seed is rotten under their clods. The garners are laid desolate. The barns are broken down. The corn is withered. And look, how do the beasts groan? They don't have anything to eat either. The herds of cattle are perplexed because they have no pasture. Yea, the flocks of sheep are made desolate. O Lord, to thee will I cry. Hear me on this. And this is what we got to remember as we're studying, as we're looking back at this, as it looks forward, and we're looking at what we already know from our study in the Revelation, and we know what's coming. The seven bowls of God's wrath are going to be so severe, there is no way of trying to numb down the horror of what's going to happen for the last couple of years on this earth, the last couple of years of the tribulation period. When we start looking at that next week, and I know you study this as well, it's, you can just read through it and not pay attention to what it says, but if you pay attention to what it says and think about how that will affect this planet will, in a very short period of time, become almost uninhabitable. It will destroy so much. And he's going to point to a few of those things as we walk through this. And he says, oh Lord, to thee will I cry. It's the only place to turn. Now, interestingly enough, let's always remember this one thing. In the end, when the bowls of God's wrath are poured out, there is one small place that will be saved that will not feel the effects of what's going on in the world, of the bowls of God's wrath. Somehow, one small place. And the scripture doesn't talk about it much, but it infers it as well. Just within the last 12 months or so, God lifted out a newly saved Israel and put them on wings of eagles, whatever that means, and stuck them over in Transjordan and dropped them down and said, I will cover you with my hand. And they stayed there in safety for the last half of the tribulation period. They will return to Jerusalem when Jesus comes to Jerusalem.
Anyone else who tried to go there?
Don't know. The Bible doesn't speak to that at all. Whether others will go or try to go, it doesn't talk to that at all. I don't know as they even know. Pardon me? Possibly. Possibly close to that. It's in Transjordan somewhere. That's all we can really say for sure. To thee, O Lord, will I cry, for the fire hath devoured the pastures. Remember, now we're looking way ahead in the future of the wilderness, and the flame hath burned all the trees of the field. The beasts of the field cry also unto thee, for the rivers of waters are dried up, absolutely turned to blood, dried up, wormwood spread everywhere, and the fire hath devoured the pastures of the wilderness. And he says this, blow ye the trumpet in Zion, sound an alarm in the holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord cometh, for it is nigh at hand. It is a day of darkness, a day of gloominess, a day of clouds, and of thick darkness. What's the difference between darkness and thick darkness? You ever been in a, and this is exactly what the term means, it's just weird, but you ever been in darkness so deep that it almost feels like film upon your face? It's not that you can't see anymore. It's that it feels like you're being smothered in darkness.
Have you ever been in a cave and they turn the light out?
Yes, I have.
I mean, that is...
And it just feels like the whole thing's just coming right down around
you.
He says this, as the morning spread upon the mountains, a great people and a strong, there hath not been ever the like, neither shall there be any more after it, even into the years of many generations. Now he starts saying, okay, now remember I talked to you about the locusts? There are a people which will be drawn down to the land of Israel, just like the locusts. A people great and strong. Never been one like them, never be will be one again. A fire devoureth before them, and behind them a flame burneth. As we dive into chapter 15, we're going to get about halfway through, no, into 16. We're going to get about halfway through 16, and we're going to meet three frogs. So it's one of those scriptures in Revelation that everybody just kind of flashes through. But these three frogs are going to inhabit certain people. If you have a frog inhabiting a people, who actually is that frog? Pardon me? You couldn't help yourself. I love that. A prince. They're demons, man. And these are the ones that are going to go around to all the leaders of the world in the name of the Antichrist and convince them to follow him down into Israel, because the Lord has his hook in the Antichrist's mouth and is drawing him, just like he drew Nebuchadnezzar down to Israel to execute his glory and his judgment upon them. A fire devoureth before them, and behind them a flame burneth. This is what I was talking about earlier. Before them, the land is as the Garden of Eden before them. Behind them, a desolate wilderness. Yea, and nothing shall escape them. This will also include the 200 million something that comes across the dried up Euphrates River from the east. The appearance of them is the appearance of horses, and as horsemen, so shall they run. Like the noise of chariots on the tops of mountains shall they leap, like the noise of flame of fire that devoureth the stubble, as a strong people set in battle array, before their face the people shall be much pained, all faces shall gather blackness. That just means all face, the dust will rise to such a level that your face will turn dark because of all the dust. This is what we call, if you were here this morning, an emergency. Don't you think? They shall run like mighty men. They shall climb the wall like men of war, like locusts, for crying out loud. They shall march every one on his ways. They shall not break their ranks, neither shall one thrust another. They shall walk every one in his path, and when they fall upon the sword, they shall not be wounded. I really don't know what to do with that verse, to be honest with you. They shall run in the city to and fro. They shall run upon the wall. They shall climb up upon the houses. They shall enter into the windows like a thief. The earth shall quake before them. The heavens shall tremble. The sun and the moon shall be dark, and the stars shall withdraw their shining. All part of Revelation 15 and 16. All part of the seven bowls. And the Lord shall utter his voice before his army, for his camp is very great. For he is strong that executeth his word. For the day of the Lord is great and terrible, and who can abide it? So Joel stops and says, you kind of got the picture here? Before I move any further, let me give you the invitation. Therefore also now saith the Lord, turn ye even to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, with mourning, and rend your heart and not your garments, and turn unto the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness, and repenteth him of the evil. And every time I read that passage, I cannot do but this. What did James say? He said this: submit yourself therefore to God, resist the devil, he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be afflicted and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to heaviness. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. I think maybe that's one thing we're missing in the church in America, at least today. We all think that God is gracious and good with a long white beard and a loving heart and a twinkle in his eye. And maybe he wears a red coat, and you know exactly what I'm talking about. And he will never hold us accountable for our sin. But what did the first century teachers teach us? And what has all through Scripture taught us from the very beginning? When you sin against God, no matter how much he has promised you, he will never leave you nor forsake you. If you get his holiness and you forget our wretchedness, if you're not repenting, if you're not on your face, if you're not tearing your clothes, if you're not throwing ashes in the air, metaphorically or literally, you don't get the horror of sin. And Joel says, who knows if he will return and repent? That's why we keep praying for our country and leave a blessing behind him, even a meal offering and a drink offering unto the Lord your God. He says, blow the trumpet in Zion, sanctify a feast, call a solemn assembly, gather the people, sanctify the congregation, assemble the elders again, gather the children and those that suck the breast, bring the babies, let the bridegroom go forth from his chamber and the bride out of her closet. Let nothing you plan get in the way. This is the important thing. Let the priests, the ministers of the Lord, weep between the porch and the altar, and let them say, spare thy people, O Lord. Give not mine heritage to reproach, that the heathen should rule over them. Wherefore should they say among the people, where is their God? And for great swaths of history, the heathen ruled over Israel. Yes, sir?
That's what happened in Nineveh. Remember Jonah and the whale, and he went and preached.
Yep.
And they repented.
He didn't even preach very hard.
Instruction didn't come.
Yeah. The Holy Spirit moved and God changed his mind. God changed his mind? You ever think about that? We're not going there tonight. Calvin, I'm not answering that question. I love Calvin's questions. Don't get me wrong. I love everybody's questions. Whew, I'm in trouble. I know that. Verse 18. Then will the Lord be jealous for his land and pity his people. Joel's becoming very specific now. Then will the Lord be jealous for his land and pity his people. Yea, the Lord will answer and say unto his people, behold, I will send you corn and wine and oil, and you shall be satisfied therewith, and I will no more make you a reproach among the heathen. They were, they will no longer be. But I will remove far off from you the northern army. Now, that's interesting, isn't it? The northern army that he's got his hook in, that they're coming down like locusts into the promised land. He doesn't say, now, this is really convoluted language here, but the original language does not say that he will move immediately the army so it doesn't touch them. He says, I will remove you. I know this says, I'll remove the army from you, but it's more clear, more accurate to say, I will remove you from the northern army. So this is the point where he picks up Israel, who has just given their life. The entire nation, almost as one, has recognized their Savior and surrendered to Christ, and he will move them over, like we said, to Transjordan, in the wilderness of Transjordan somewhere, and cover them with his hand. Where was I? Thank you. I will remove far away off from you the northern army and will drive him into a land barren and desolate. And that's where it clicks. It's actually two constructs. That's the first construct. The second construct is, then I will remove them to a land barren and desolate, with his face toward the east sea and the hinder part toward the utmost sea, and his stink shall come up, which means he dies, and his ill savor shall come up because he hath done horrific things, great things, not a good translation. Fear not, O land, be glad and rejoice, for the Lord will do great things. Be not afraid, ye beasts of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness do spring, for the tree beareth her fruit, the fig tree, the vine do yield their strength. I'm going to bring it all back. Be glad then, you children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he hath given you the former rain moderately, and he will now, at this point, begin to cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain, and the latter rain in the first month. Oh, don't have time. But that's an amazing promise right there. We'd have to hold out the whole calendar of Israel to understand that. And the floor shall be full of wheat, the vats shall overflowing with wine and oil, and I will restore. Here's a promise. You need to put this one on your fridge. Anytime you think you lose everything or things that can't be replaced, and I will restore to you the years that the locust hath eaten, the cankerworm and the caterpillar and the palmer worm, my great army which I sent among you. God is able to restore to you what you think you've lost. And you shall eat in plenty and be satisfied and praise the name of the Lord your God. He hath dealt wondrously with you, and my people shall never be ashamed. And you shall know that, here it is, I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am the Lord your God and none else, and my people shall never be ashamed. Now, what just happened? God says all this stuff is taking place. The army is coming down. I will intervene, Jesus says. And in my intervention, I will send you into safety. Then I will send this army into a place where they will be desolate and dead, completely gone. Their stink will rise up. And then I will restore all of that which had been destroyed by them and by others who had no respect for whom? For God's land and God's promise and God's people. And who are we talking about specifically? We're talking about Israel. We're going to make it. I promise you. And it shall come to pass afterward. After what? After he puts everything right. And from our understanding of eschatology, the book of Revelation and other things, we understand that means that time when Christ comes in clouds of glory and puts an end to the battle, puts an end to the armies that are attacking Israel, sets one foot on the Mount of Olives, it splits in two, and he walks across a really short valley to the throne room of David, and he sits on Mount Zion on the throne where he belongs. Now, what is that little short valley? Anybody can tell me? Kidron's a little bit up from that. It's called Erash Shararash. Erash Shararash. The Valley of Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat means God is judge. Literally. This is the Valley of Judgment. The Valley of Jehoshaphat. Verse 29, and also upon the servants, upon the handmaids of those days, I will pour out my spirit. I will show wonders in the heavens and on the earth, blood and fire and pillars and smoke. That is what I showed at before I came. The sun shall be turned to darkness, the moon to blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, as the Lord hath said, and in the remnant whom the Lord shall call. The remnant is Israel. For behold, in those days and in that time when I shall bring again, in other words, bring back from captivity, Judah and Jerusalem, I will gather all nations, and I will bring them down to the valley of Jehoshaphat, and I will plead with them. And pleading is not asking in this case. Pleading is revealing the evidence of sin. I will plead with them for my people, Israel, and for my heritage, Israel, whom they, the nations he's bringing down to the valley of Jehoshaphat, have scattered among the nations and parted my lands. Stop. Those are the two great sins of the Gentile nations. We have scattered his children to the four winds, to the nations. They've been that way. They're still that way. There's more Jews in New York City than there are in the entire nation of Israel. His children, His people, His chosen people are everywhere in the world. They've come back in dribs and drabs over the last 60 years. But they're still scattered. And now the greatest sin is this. They have parted my land. We have taken that land which God stuck Abraham on that little hill and turned him all the way around and said, all this is yours. It will be yours in perpetuity and forever. And we have finally come to this wonderful consensus in our world. Seriously, every nation is at consensus. Except maybe three or four, and we ain't one of those. That this land does not really belong to Israel. It belongs to the Palestinians. It belongs to the Arabs. It's a holy place for all who are sons of Ishmael. But it does not belong to Israel. And they're going to be carted out for that. And they have also done this. Listen carefully. Cast lots for my people. Take them into slavery. They have given a boy for a harlot and sold a girl for wine that they might drink. Last estimate. 13 plus million underage children in our world are in sexual slavery right now. It is, in my opinion, and we can have an argument about this because there's a lot of issues in our world, the greatest travesty of justice that we let go on ever. And we don't talk about it. We don't rise against it. I mean, honestly, what can we do? I get that. But something's got to be done. Something should be at least tried to be done before. We don't. It is one of the largest industries in the world right now, monetarily. And all our kids are suffering. It's, God's going to hold them accountable. Yea, and what have you to do with me, O Tyre and Zidon and all the coasts of Palestine? I say that in anger because it's written in anger. Because listen what he says. Will you render me recompense? Do you think I want something you had to make all this go away? Do you think I'm going to forgive you? Do you think I'm going to get rid of the sin? I'm just going to wipe it away because you're going to give me a gift? He says this, and if you recompense me swiftly and speedily, will I return your recompense on your own head? Because you have taken my silver, my gold, and carried into your temples my goodly pleasant things that began with Babylon and have moved on. The children also of Judah and the children of Jerusalem have you sold to the Grecians. Who are the Grecians? They're us. They're the Gentiles everywhere. That's another way of saying us. He says, you nations have sold my people over and over again. Behold, I will raise them out of the place whither you have sold them. I will return your recompense upon your own head, and I will sell your sons and your daughters into the hand of the children of Judah, and they shall sell them to the Sabians and a people afar off, for the Lord has spoken it. Stop. We had this discussion 3-4 weeks ago. Matthew 26. Christ is wrapping up his discussion with his disciples on Tuesday late afternoon. After coming out of the temple, they asked him, what will be the sign of your coming? What will be the sign of your return? And he went into this long diatribe. And in the end, he said this, and I'll just paraphrase it. You know the story well. He said, at that time, Son of Man will come, and he will set up judgment. You know where they were when he said that? Just north of the temple, maybe 50 feet north of the temple. And perhaps he did this, turned like this, and looked at the valley of Jehoshaphat, 300 yards in front of him. And he will set up judgment, and he will gather all the nations unto himself. You could see more of this in Zechariah and Zephaniah. But this is clear indication of this. He will gather all the nations to himself, and he will separate them on his right hand and his left hand, the wolves from the sheep. Nations. Not people. Not individuals. The nations. The conglomerates of human society that have either stood with his brethren, the Israelites, or stood against his brethren historically, the Israelites. And he will say, eventually, because we're going to just skip the other part because you know the story very well, to those on his left hand, I believe, he will say, "Depart from me. Never knew you." He's taken his throne. What does it mean to depart from the king of the earth? It means you don't get to exist no more. Depart from me. I never knew you. When I was in prison, you didn't visit me. When I was dying of thirst, you didn't bring me drink. When I was dying of hunger, you didn't bring me food. They'll raise their hand and say, "Lord, we don't remember ever doing that. When did we ever ignore you?" He says, "When you did it to the least of these, my brethren," all those he just brought from Transjordan gathered around him. "When you did this to the least of these, my brethren, you have done it unto me." And I can show you the other scriptures when we have time. Those nations will not exist ever again. They will be wiped. He will take the people that are left and he will disperse them. And the nations and the governments and the history will be no more. They will be desolate. Their resources will be desolated. Zechariah tells us that. And they will not be part of those who will worship the king during the millennial kingdom. I love my country. You love your country, don't you? I don't agree with a lot of things they're doing lately, but I didn't agree with them. If I had lived 150 years ago, I wouldn't have agreed with a lot of things they did there and then either. So, and there's never been a time any of us would have agreed with everything our nation did. We did some dumb things, some stupid things, and some horrific things. But I love my country. But right now, I'm not really sure we'll be around in the millennial kingdom. I'm not smart enough to know if we will or not. God can do anything. We'll finish. Verse 9, "Proclaim ye among the Gentiles. Prepare war, wake up the mighty men, let all the men of war draw near, let them go up. Beat your plowshares into swords and your pruning hooks into spears. Let the weak say, I am strong. Assemble yourselves together and come, all you heathen. Gather yourselves together round about," my favorite King James word, "thither cause thy mighty ones to come down, O Lord. Let the heathen be wakened and come up to the valley of Jehoshaphat, for there will I sit to judge all the heathen round about." You know how long that takes? I have nowhere in Scripture that actually tells me this. But this is the only thing in Scripture that would even begin to explain the missing 75 days. It takes 75 days. "Put ye in the sickle," Revelation 15, "for the harvest is ripe. Come, get you down, for the press is full. The fats overflow, for their wickedness is great. Multitudes, multitudes in the valley of Jehoshaphat. For the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision." The sun of the moon, emphasized prior, "shall be darkened, the stars shall withdraw their light, the Lord shall roar out of Zion and utter his voice from Jerusalem. The heavens and the earth shall shake, but the Lord will be the hope of his people and the strength of the children of Israel. So shall you know that I am the Lord your God, dwelling in Zion, my holy mountain. Then shall Jerusalem be holy, and there shall no strangers pass through her anymore." And then, just the first little kiss of what the millennial kingdom will be like. And it shall come to pass in that day that the mountains shall drop down new wine, the hills shall flow with milk, and all the rivers of Judah will flow with waters. And a fountain shall come forth out of the house of the Lord, and shall water the valley of Chittim. Egypt shall be a desolation, there it is. Edom shall be a desolate wilderness for the violence against the children of Judah, and because they have shed innocent blood in their land. But Judah shall dwell forever, and Jerusalem from generation to generation, for I will cleanse their blood that I have not cleansed, for the Lord dwelleth in Zion. Isn't that an awesome book?
Amen.
Yes?
Is this the same as Armageddon?
Yes.
Okay.
Armageddon, absolutely. This is one particular description. We'll see other descriptions as we get closer. This is one particular description of how Armageddon begins. It's by the hook of God in their mouth, drawing them down, separating his people, preparing them, and then he comes forth and puts an end to it. Father God, thank you for your mercy. What do you think? Do I get any appreciation? Never mind. I don't know if God really appreciates that, or if it matters at all to him, but I'm getting pretty good at this timing thing. Father God, thank you for your mercy, your grace, your love, your joy, your mercy, your grace. What can I say? Thank you that our hope rests in you. And I would pray, Father, I would pray, because I think it's important that this nation you have blessed me with would remain intact and remain through the kingdom. But I can't speak to that. For you are holy. In Jesus' name, amen.